So first of all, at the very outset, I would like to thank ACP India chapter, Dr. Narasingh Verma, Dr. Anuj Maheshwari, Dr. Panda, having given me this opportunity to speak on this subject. And thanks not only because I have given this opportunity, but because this forum basically is addressing to primary healthcare. And as Dr. Murugnathan yesterday mentioned, that Christian Bernard, and he quoted him, that he focused that if suppose he could have focused on primary prevention or the primary healthcare, he would have saved millions of lives. Similarly, if you have heard Dr. Anuj Maheshwari talking about the theme of this particular conference, he talked about that primary healthcare, if suppose we nip the bud right in the beginning, probably it will save many complications and many patients requiring tertiary care. And therefore, this is important that we focus on some messages which have to be given to the primary care physicians. And as the Dean ICP has mentioned, that we need to be building bridges between the primary healthcare and the second and the tertiary healthcare. We need to be developing. Having said that, we know that making a change is something which is important, and personally, I feel and I relate to this message because out of 30 years of my practice, 20 years I've devoted to rural areas. And this is why I think that this is something which is really important, that we are talking about primary healthcare and delivering some messages. This is not an emotional statement, but it is basically something which is pretext to my talk. Okay. So the talk given to me is basically talking about the second generation basal insulins. Now, once we are talking of this, we know that the moment we talk about insulin initiation in our patients, there is a lot of resistance that comes in various ways. And the fact remains that the HbA1c goal is far-fetched. Hardly 24 to 28% patients, they are on goal. And if you talk of insulin initiation, then we wait for HbA1c of nearly 9.1 before we really think of initiating insulin. So these are the factors. Why this happens? Because this happens the moment we start talking about injectable insulin with our patients. A lot of myths around insulins, a lot of problems, maybe interference in their lifestyle, wrong notions about insulin. Maybe that they think that is end of the road. This is the last thing which probably they will like to have in their life. If we talk of physicians, then there are certain barriers, hypoglycemia on the top, whether we talk of primary care physicians or diabetologists, everyone is worried about hypoglycemia, and rightly so, because hypoglycemia is sitting in the driver's seat as far as the cardiovascular outcomes are concerned. At the same time, it is also responsible for converting a good patient into a bad patient. So that's why we don't want this to happen to our patients whenever we are talking of intensifying our treatment in diabetic subject. So why this is happening? Can we do something, or has the science done something to the type of insulins now we are having with us in addressing to these problems? And this is precisely what I will be talking about. So we have seen a lot of technological changes happening in insulin, NPH, GLA-100, then the degludec, and in 2011, we had GLA-300. What difference has that made? So has this solved certain problems? And probably we have reached to a near ideal basal insulin. Why so? Because this is having near physiological basal profile. It is practically peakless. It is truly once a day. The incidence of hypoglycemia is really, really low, especially the nocturnal one. The titration with them and the intensification with them is pretty easy. The timing, which is normally bound with the meals, is something which is not there with this generation 2 insulins. The glycemic variability, which we now talk of, time in range and others. So we need less of glycemic variability that is also positively affected with generation 2 basal insulins. And then a special variety of patients, like patients with DKD or patients those who are elderly, wherein we are really finding difficult to manage hyperglycemia, therein certainly this has a role to play. Then coming to the newer devices which has come to our hand, and that is the that is alleviating the injection pain and some complexities which happen with the usage of pens that are also taken care of. And then COVID has given us insight as far as the telemedicine is concerned, the usage is concerned. More of us are using it nowadays, and that is something because of the simplistic algorithms, they can be now instituted even using telemedicine. And if we talk of monitoring, then monitoring, very less monitoring is required with these long-acting basal insulins. And these are the two articles which are published. And we have just heard Dr. Manoj Chawla, and the expert group wherein I was also part has focused that yes, during these difficult COVID times, basal insulin initiation was something which was very handy, and that change gradually happened during this COVID times as well. So that brings me to the overview of my presentation. I'll be talking about what basal second generation insulins we are exposed to, and then a comparison between the options which are available to us, and then finally the innovative pen which is available. Now, if we talk of the changes which has happened over a period of time, we can see that the basal insulin initiation is now unanimously recommended by all organizations. And therefore, it has become a rule of thumb now, practically, that we have to initiate insulin with basal insulin. So premixes, probably they are sitting at the back seat, excepting for some specific indications wherein obviously we can use that. Now, what are these second generation insulin? If we talk of GLA 300 or the glargine 300, it is just not a concentrated insulin. It is just not like any other U200 of concentrated plain insulin. It is having a different PK and PD profile. It acquires a smaller volume in the subcutaneous tissue, and then there is a slower release, and it makes the PK/PD different from its counterpart U100. And here is a difficult to perform clamp study, which talks of the differentiating points between the PK/PD profile. And you can clearly see that U300 is performing better, longer, with lesser variability using this PK/PD profile. This point has been clearly established. Coming on to the HbA1c reduction, then GLA 300 demonstrates better HbA1c reduction as compared to GLA 100 at the end of maybe 12 weeks. And therefore, achieving two target becomes easier with the use of GLA 300. So the advantages, what we have with generation 2 basal insulin over generation 1 is that it is having a stable and prolonged action, more than 24 hours. It's having less glycemic variability. It is effective and sustained glycemic control, less overall and nocturnal hypoglycemia, safer during titration and maintenance phase. I'll come to this point later on. Minimal weight gain and flexibility of dosing. It is free of that mealtime association. So these are the advantages which we get with generation 2 insulins. Now, what are we having in terms of generation 2? That is degludec and U300 glargine. So once we have these two options, we have to see what these two formulations or the compounds they actually do. The addition trial that basically compared the GLA 300 with GLA 100, and the program BEGIN compared the IDEG versus GLA 100. And in both the situations, you can see that GLA 300 had lower rate of any time and nocturnal hypoglycemia, while the IDEG, it had lower rate of nocturnal hypoglycemia only. So there are certain subtle differences, but overall, generation 2, in terms of hypoglycemia, they are better at as compared to generation 1. Now, there are certain differences if we talk of the methodology in which these insulins, they work. If we talk of GLA 300, once they are injected, it goes into alkaline pH, and therein it precipitates, and then the active metabolite gradually releases from the subcutaneous milieu into the circulation. While in case of IDEG, the moment you inject, it forms multi-hexamers, and then gradually the monomers, they are released. And herein, it is 99% bound with albumin. So there are differences as far as the mechanism of release is concerned, and this makes some difference. If suppose the person is having low albumin, then certainly IDEC will have a different PK/PD. This was the first trial which compared head-on the GLA-300 versus the degludec-100. This was a multicentric, open-label, randomized, active control, two-arm trial. And in one arm, it was GLA-300 in the dose of 0.2 units per kg as per label. And in the second arm, it was IDEC-100 once daily as per label. And then it was followed up and the results, because it was to meet HbA1c target. So in both the arms, the HbA1c target was met. But what happened during this course is revealed here. During the titration phase, what is titration phase? The titration phase basically when we are trying to intensify our dosages so as to achieve HbA1c target. And here during this titration phase, which is very important, because during this titration phase, if suppose your patient develops hypoglycemia, then probably he'll stop titrating. He'll become a bad patient. He will probably be gulping carbohydrates. He will not be following your advice. So if suppose that happens during this titration phase, then it really leads to not achieving HbA1c target. And if you see the head-to-head comparison, then GLA-300 performed significantly better in terms of hypoglycemia during this period, whether it is incidence or the event rates, using both the cutoffs, whether it is less than 70 or less than 54 milligram percent. The sub-analysis gave us further insight, the bright renal. It gave us further insight that in compromised EGFR patients, where the EGFR was less than 60, there in more number of patients, they achieved their HbA1c target, and that too without getting hypoglycemia. So along with safety, you get a better HbA1c profile even in the renally compromised patient. And this was a good thing which happened with U300. Coming to glycemic variability, which we talk of nowadays, because if there is lesser glycemic variability, there are more chances that the person will spend time within that range. So the lower variability was seen in this CLAMP study against IDEC-100. I take this study with a pinch of salt because there is another CLAMP study which talks otherwise. But if we talk of the time in range and head-to-head comparison using CGM, then we can see that the time in range with both the options, IDEC-100 and GLA-300, that is okay. But if we talk of time below range, then we can clearly see that there is less chance of going below range with the use of GLA-300, meaning whereby that the patient will have lesser chances of hypoglycemia. Once again, it will safeguard the intensification process, which we really want in our patients. Now, these randomized controlled trials should also be replicating themselves in the real world situation. So this is one care randomized the real world trial using in the adult type 1 diabetic patients. And herein we can see that the time in range is practically the same. But if we are talking specifically of the range between 70 to 140 and 70 to 180, then you can see that the green bar in the lower chart is taller as compared to the pink one. And that denotes basically more number of patients, those who have attained that target. So if we talk of the number of patients achieving target without getting hypoglycemia, whether nocturnal or anytime hypoglycemia, more chances of getting to the goal with the use of GLA-300 as against IDEC-100. Another real-world trial that was done in insulin-naive type 2 diabetic patients, and this is the ATOS real-world evidence, wherein one-third of the patients, they came from India, and therefore that is reflecting our type of population here also. So one-third patients here in India, and once again, initiation of GLA-300 in people with type 2 diabetes, uncontrolled UNOIDs, resulted in improved glycemic control with low rates of hypoglycemia and minimum weight change. This was replication of the randomized control trial. Now, the subgroup analysis of this ATOS, which was published or presented in ADA 2021, and here, once again, the subgroup analysis is talking of the high-risk population or the critical population, that is elderly. And once again, it has shown that it is safer to use this in elderly population. At the same time, another subgroup analysis talking of the renally impaired patients, wherein once again, it is found to be better in terms of getting hypoglycemia in that sort of situation. So overall, what are the advantages of GLA-300 over IDEC-100? These are the two long acting basal insulins we are having. So lesser glycemic variability with GLA-300, lesser anytime hypoglycemia during titration phase, lesser nocturnal hypoglycemia during titration, and lesser risk of hypoglycemia when albumin levels are low, and better time in range profiles, lesser weight gain with the use of U-300. Then coming to how do we give this using devices? And when we are using various types of pens, we know that there are at times situation when the patient fumbles with different type of cartridge, different type of pen, whenever we are trying to change the type of insulin, that leads to some problems with the usage of pen. And this is something which happens. It's a practical problem. And therefore, there are errors in insulinization which can happen, mismatch of cartridge and pen, which can happen, mistaking rapid acting insulin with basal, which can be dangerous. And therefore, we need a more patient-friendly device. And herein, this is innovation, that this middle portion is basically the cartridge, which is the part of the pen as such. And therefore, it is a dedicated part of that pen. So there are no chances of mixing or maybe error once we are using this particular device. It has got certain extra benefits. It's very light. It needs very less pressure. The overall period of time is just 5 seconds in required to inject the insulin. It is containing 450 units of insulin. At the same time, the pricing has also gone down, which is very important in Indian scenario. And therefore, this device has made the application or injection in a very simplistic manner, in a more aesthetic manner, in a more durable manner, and in a more functional manner. So in summary, the message is that we know that initiation of insulin is really a challenge. We need to spend nearly 20 to 30 minutes before we can really convince the person and bring him out of his all sorts of myths as far as the insulin initiation is concerned. And unless and until we initiate insulin in time, at the optimal time rather, we will not be able to achieve targets in more number of patients. And therefore the message here is that you now have a very long basal insulin, which can be really started, instituted without significant hypoglycemia risk in a very simplistic manner. If suppose the person can afford, this can be a very safe option. Even using telemedication, this is something which can be used, and we have been using it very successfully. So this is the message for all primary care physicians as such, that they should now try to use, at least get the taste of long-acting basal insulins and get more number of patients to their goal. Thank you so much for your patient hearing.